And just as we get started, for all of those that are new to this gathering, whether you've seen it on YouTube or have joined us for retreats and other gatherings, what I offer is known as a transmission of presence. What that means is everything I say intuitively is guided information directly from the Akashic records. And this isn't a space that I get into when I'm with you. This is a space I live in. In the very beginning of my journey, the self would get out of the way to bring this through. And then the process of that self getting out of the way disappeared. And this, over a 10-year process, has become a fully embodied living transmission. And so what I say is intuitively guided to speak to the journeys that we're all having. Even though we're having unique journeys, there are many things we have in common. And the sound of my voice brings through a healing energy to clear what needs to be cleared, to uplift what's ready to be activated, and so forth. So the energy is both an activating and clearing energy. Whatever we're feeling in the process is what's moving out of our field. So even if you have some feelings that arise, it doesn't mean you're necessarily disagreeing or in discord with what I'm saying. It means that what I am bringing through is moving things out of your field. And of course, what you're feeling is what's healing. And because there's a healing energy in the sound of my voice, what I'm saying is not necessarily what you should leave tonight with more motivation to try to do more in your life. It's almost as if I'm narrating what the energy that you're absorbing will bring into your life after tonight. So it's not like this is done, this is all done for you. All the work is done on your behalf. This is my absolute joy to bring forth this and to serve you. And all you have to do is receive. Receive, listen, feel. Laugh if you feel called to laugh, you know. And then at the end, there'll be some time for some questions. And of course, in my journey on a daily basis, I go through energetic upgrades. In my experience, you know, like there are experiences where you have awakenings, and sometimes you have these really pivotal awakenings in your life. And you can look back and go, that was a pivotal awakening. Eventually, the energy builds to the point where every breath is its own awakening. In my experience, life is an ongoing awakening, and life kind of revolves around that. And on a daily basis, I go through energetic upgrades, and I download new teachings on a daily basis. And so, when we come together, it's always going to be new. And tonight I want to talk to you about something new. Something very important. I want to give a new perspective on oneness. I don't know if any of you have heard of the phrase emotional oneness. You probably haven't because I just made it up. Just made it up. And it encapsulates what I'm going to call a brand new teaching. It's going to clarify a lot of this journey. Emotional oneness. Because on the spiritual journey, it's very common for the pursuit of oneness to be what motivates you into a mystical journey. Right? When I say oneness, I mean to experience undifferentiated union with the divine. Whether that's to discover the oneness within you or to merge into the oneness of the universe around you. So, you know, we all have different ways of perceiving it. Sometimes it's emerging into what's around you, and sometimes it's a discovery of what's within you. And oftentimes, The interesting thing about oneness is that whether you've tasted it or not, it's always something that's pursued. It's very interesting. Sometimes it's, I'm pursuing it because I haven't tasted it. And sometimes I've tasted it and it didn't last long enough and now I want more. I had a sample of oneness. Now I'd like a scoop. Oh, please, Lord, give me a scoop. What's funny is that sometimes if you taste oneness, the chasing of it after that becomes more desperate. Because once you taste it, there's a sense of, now I know what I lost. And every moment gets judged if it seems absent of that union of oneness. And I'm going to explain tonight, there's a reason why we have experiences of a taste and it doesn't last. There's a reason for that. There's a reason why people chase after oneness and don't find it. It seems like it's a very popular thing to chase, but not as popular of a thing to find. Now that's interesting. Everyone's looking for it. And even if you thought you found it, you're still part of the search party. That's kind of weird. That's weird. And so let's call that cosmic oneness. Cosmic oneness, whether it's being one with all that is within yourself, or it's dissolving into the one of the universe around you. That's cosmic oneness. And usually the reason why we pursue cosmic oneness is because we think it's going to resolve one of two things, usually. Usually it seems as if we think cosmic oneness is either going to be the very change of circumstances that's going to finally satisfy you, or you think that the oneness is going to change how you feel about the circumstances you face. Maybe sounds familiar, right? So some people think, okay, once I merge with the one, that's going to open up the magical doors, all my circumstances are going to change. Once I open that door, like a game show. Once I'm one with God, party time! I'm going to wake up and all of a sudden all my circumstances will change. And some people say, well, it may not change my circumstances, but I'm going to feel a lot better about my circumstances. And that seems to be why we are chasing oneness, because we either want to change how we feel or change the circumstances that we face. Does that make sense? Seems like two pretty popular reasons. And yet, we chase and chase and look and search and contemplate. We try to clear. We try to heal. We go about the spiritual journey in exactly the way it's been presented for so many years. And there's a brand new spiritual paradigm being offered. And it's actually a revolution and a refuge from the old spiritual journey. Because the old spiritual journey brings you to this threshold, but it can't take you any further. The old spiritual journey can get you excited about oneness. It can make you think oneness is going to change a lot of things in your life, but it can't help you find it. The new spiritual evolution can help you discover the truth of it. Because there's a reason why people either don't have long-lasting experiences of oneness or haven't found it. And in the absence of finding it or having the long-lasting experience, they imagine how differently they're going to feel when they find it, or they imagine all the different things that will happen in their life once it's found. And that becomes the spiritual fantasy, right? You have people in your life, maybe they're not so nice to you. Oh, they're not going to exist when I'm one. They're going to go away. Hey, so-and-so, your days are numbered. I'm real close to oneness. You're going to disappear real quick. Or it's, oh, they'll be here, but I just won't be triggered by them. I'll be in this state. Like, it's the weirdest thing in the spiritual journey. The biggest spiritual fantasy is to be energetically immune to egos. Like, we want to be in a world of egos and just not be triggered by people. Why is that a fantasy? It's almost like we want to be able to confirm that we're doing everything correctly. Like, it's an Olympic sport. And even if you do it right, the funniest thing is you won't be able to keep it to yourself. You'll try to call in your spiritual friends. Hey, did you see that? Do you see that? Accepting what is? I totally nailed it. I totally nailed it. Accepting what is? See that person come over here with their attitude? I didn't even flinch. Not even like, no, none of that. Not even a flinch. My eye didn't even move. Right? Like, not even like I'm trying to be a spiritual person, but my eye is saying, you're being an asshole. No, none of that. No, I nailed accepting what is. Did you see that? I nailed it. Why do we do that? Why do we do that? It's hilarious. And we think that when we experience oneness, that's what it's going to be like. But I want to talk to you about oneness is a beautiful thing. The transmission I offer is a living transmission of oneness. At a certain point, I'm here to tell you from experience, oneness becomes your experience of every breath is oneness. So much that you actually forget what oneness is and what oneness isn't, which is when oneness arises. You are freed of the conversation about oneness because there's nothing but that. There's no distinction anymore. And part of the scariness for a lot of people is that they get to their experience of oneness, but then when you lose distinction, it feels like it's disappearing. But it's not disappearing, it's that you're actually merging into it. And you're not able to perceive it anymore because you're too close, because you are it. So part of you becoming one is that your experience of oneness disappears. Which is why I often say the highest spiritual experience is no experience at all. Because no experience means you've become it. You're not looking at it separately like an object. You've become the truth, not the collector of it. But that living experience of being the oneness that you're trying to merge into or discover within yourself, that actually isn't the appropriate focus on a spiritual journey. That's why a lot of people are looking for it and they can't find it. Even people that find it for 10 minutes, they're still looking for it because it's not the right focus. If you notice, being in pursuit of oneness just makes you hungrier. And you're hungrier for oneness, and now oneness becomes an object, and that makes it almost impossible to understand the truth of it. Even if you've been taught you're already the one, then you're just a hungry, hungry ego walking around saying you're already the one, and you're still hungry. You're saying the right words, but someone in my position energetically doesn't just hear the words, I tune in energetically to the hunger, and I can feel exactly what's going on. So the words are great, but because you go, oh, I am already the one. Interesting. Because someone in my position is tuning into whether the words and the vibration are one in experience. If you're speaking from experience, it's true. If you're speaking about a different experience that's not happening right now, it's not true. So just as another little aside, someone in position doesn't say yes or no based on ideas. I'm saying yes and no to what you're saying and what your experience are not on the same page. So the best bet on a spiritual journey is always speak about and be true to what you are now, not what you've been. Because what you've been is wonderful, but if what you speak about is not where you're at, you're not doing yourself the greatest service. So someone could say the most beautiful words, all is one. And if they're not in the all is one experience, I would say that's not true. And people would go, what was he talking about? All isn't one? No, all is one when you're in that space. And so what I want to teach you is what's the doorway that brings you into the space of the experience that you're hungry for? Because when you're in the space, the joy is what you're freed of is the hunger. The oneness doesn't satisfy your hunger. You become satisfied by being freed of your hunger. Does that make sense? And so by chasing oneness, you don't get freed of your hunger, you just become hungrier. So that's why I'm talking tonight about emotional oneness, because once emotional oneness is discovered, emotional oneness is what triggers inside of you the externalized manifestation where you spontaneously realize you're one with all that is. So it's almost like we're chasing oneness on a cosmic level. We're not engaging with emotional oneness, which is actually what triggers the universe to bring you that bigger experience. It's almost like the cosmic oneness is a bigger magnified manifestation of emotional oneness. Does that make sense? So actually, the easier journey, the more heart-centered journey is, let's work on emotional oneness. And once that's all in alignment, the realization that you're one with all as the universe will happen spontaneously. Doesn't that kind of make more sense? Otherwise, you're just chasing and chasing. And again, we've all done that to realize it might not work. And some of us are so innocent and heart-centered, we go, I'm not doing it right. Well, no, it just doesn't work. It just doesn't work. Maybe I'm just not doing it right. That's very nice, but no. No one's doing it right because it doesn't work. Emotional oneness is internal alignment. Your mind and your heart are soulmates. And emotional oneness is when the soulmates of mind and heart have reunited in holy matrimony. And when that is disproportionate or imbalanced, your mind seems to be in the way of your heart, or your mind and heart are saying two different things. There's almost like your mind and heart seem to be competing for attention, and you seem to be in the middle of this battlefield, or you're the one that's trying to keep your mind silent so you can focus on your heart, or you're trying to ease the fearful heart because of how noisy the mind's being, and you're in the middle of a battlefield, a spiritual battlefield. And it's all because the mind and the heart are not on the same page. So what brings the mind and the heart into holy matrimony that reunites the mind and the heart as sacred soulmates is you deepening your relationship with your own innocence, your own inner child. In a lot of spiritual traditions, the focus is on understanding, unraveling, overcoming, transcending the ego. And ego gets a real bad rap. In fact, in some spiritual traditions, if you have confidence, people think you have an ego. Confidence is actually an aspect of your soul. And when you take the heart-centered journey, you realize ego is just a character, an inflated character, that your inner child concocts as a way of getting the attention from others it didn't feel it gained from the past. So ego is an attention-seeking device on the psychological level that the inner child employs. And if you're trying to unravel your ego, destroy it, and get away from it, you're sending messages of abandonment, resistance, isolation to your inner child. And then your inner child has to get even darker to get your attention, saying, I'm not going to be loved by them, but they're never going to ignore me. Then the inner child becomes what's called the shadow. And that inner child, that memory of innocence within your consciousness, is so desperate for your loving attention. And it takes the back seat and perceives your spiritual journey the way it's been for so many years as the sibling who gets all the attention. And that inner child starts to get really resentful of spirituality. And then when it's time for you to talk to your inner child, you try to bring to it all the spiritual stuff you've learned, and that pisses it off. It gets so pissed off. and your inner child will remember every spiritual thing you've said, and at a certain point, it will use it against you. And your inner child will be the biggest guru you've ever met and will deconstruct everything you've ever learned, so you will have nothing in the way of facing what demands your loving attention. What you don't want to do is bring spiritual philosophy to your innocence, because it will get extremely upset. Because the inner child perceives spirituality as what is more worthy of your attention than it. And then it will become the saboteur that tries to sabotage your spiritual journey and all of your life until you have nothing left but the willingness to give it the attention it seeks. It's kind of badass. And some of us, we don't do it maliciously, it's just we don't know. We're trying to do the best we can, trying to be on a spiritual journey, but our spiritual journey gives us a focus other than focusing on our heart. And if we just focus on deepening our relationship with our innocence, kind of like, I'm not here to say, get out of your ego. I'd never say anything like that, because everything I teach you to do, every way I talk to you, every way I instruct you to talk to yourself is exactly how you would talk to a five-year-old in pain. And any teaching that does not match the way you would talk to a child in pain, I'm going to help you deconstruct. And when you get emotionally adept to this kind of heart-centered energy, it will just leave a bad taste in your mouth. It won't make sense. Like, that teaching doesn't make sense anymore. Because it's not how you're going to talk to a child. So the focus of the spiritual journey is bring the mind and the heart back into the reunited joy of holy matrimony once you and your innocence are back on the same page and that team is together as one. That triggers in you the readiness to then bring forth a bigger realization of oneness. But you can't have the bigger realization of oneness. And the bigger realization, when it goes in that order, sticks. And it's called abiding. You have the oneness realization, and that's the way you live your life. You're not trying to live like that. It just happens. Because you're working from the inside out, not from the outside in. So, and what's interesting is your inner child, which is the innocence of your consciousness, is the guardian of your soul. And until you have given the attention to your innocence that it demands, it won't allow the things that you're here to create and experience in your life to be recognized in your present moment reality. Did you know that changing your relationship with your inner child is what actually triggers the floodgates of abundance to pour into your life? That's a fascinating discovery. That it's actually your innocence that says, I'm not going to give you permission to your infinite flowing abundance so you can then manifest all the things that are going to take your attention onto something else and I'm going to be left in the dust again. I'm going to wait till I know that you and I are on the same page and that when you get your abundance, you're not going to abandon me again. It's fascinating. It's fascinating. It's fascinating. Just like the inner child that says, I'm not going to open up the door and give you an experience of oneness until I know that we're on the same page, so that when that door of oneness opens up, oh, there's your next God, there's your next idol, I'm left behind again. I got abandoned again. Emotional oneness is you having a heart-centered relationship with your innocence that brings your mind and your heart together as lovers, not as opposing forces on a spiritual battlefield existing within your body. Because when that battlefield is active, the world around you seems tumultuous and scary. Usually we're chasing the oneness because, like I said, we don't like the way our experiences feel, or we want to change our circumstances. But the irony is, when you want to change your circumstances or don't like the way things feel, that's actually a sign that your mind and heart are not on the same page. In fact, the desire to chase oneness is another sign that your mind and heart are not on the same page. So why not just bring your mind and heart on the same page and let everything else fall into play? Seems much easier, doesn't it? See, we're now in a time in history we can actually talk about the absolute truth of this. And we can actually approach it in a way that is completely functional. And thankfully. Completely honest. And rooted in our hearts. So think of it this way, because I'm about to dispel another myth of oneness. Some people think, like we all experience each other as we're all different aspects of oneness. Like we're all the one, but we're all different characters. We're all different expressions of oneness. And in oneness, there is still individuality. So we're not all trying to act like the same one. Like we're not here to be robots, you know what I mean? We're not here to like take away our personalities and just have no uniqueness. When you're one with all that is, you still have a personality, you're still unique. So we're all here to be different expressions of the same one. And there's this weird myth that when you become one with all that is, which even if you think you're already one with all that is, or you walk around with the philosophy of everyone's already one with all that is, as if that should spare you of a journey, right? Oh, we're already one. So what? Because it doesn't matter if you've heard someone say we're all one, and then you just repeat that. What matters is if you have gone deep enough to extinguish the hunger. Because once you extinguish the hunger, then you can feel the one that you are, not just know the one that you are, or repeat the one that you are. And there's this weird idea that when I become one, all of a sudden I won't see individuals anymore. I won't engage in conversations with individuals because that would be called separation. Oh, someone will ask me, how do I get to the store? I can't give you advice because I'm not separate anymore. Even though that answer will still be responding to the person anyway. No, I'm not in separation. I can't converse as an individual. That's ridiculous. Instead, the more you realize the one that you are, the more relationship becomes more important to you. And think of it this way, everything is consciousness. We are all unique expressions of consciousness. Your body is a manifestation of consciousness. But if you are not relating to your body in the most intimate way that you would relate to a child, it doesn't feel like it's one with you. It's like a child you carry within you that doesn't feel like it's important until you give it attention. So even though this body is a manifestation of the totality of consciousness, doesn't mean the body doesn't act as a separate expression of consciousness. And some people would say, oh, talking to the body, that's separation. No, it's not. Separation doesn't actually exist. You're the one, all is the one, and the one referring to the one is actually a state of devotion. So saying to the body, hi, I love you. Thank you for being with me today. You're such an amazing body. You're nailing it. I love you. If there's anything you need from me today, please let me know. In the meantime, thank you for being a part of this journey with me. You think that's separation? That's God embracing its own godly nature in the highest state of radiant devotion. Why do people have issues with digestion and food? Because they don't talk to their food. Hi, beautiful food. I'm going to absorb the highest nutrition in this food, and I'm going to enjoy every bite, and I thank you for being a part of my journey. You're playing a very important role. Thank you so much. Hey, body, I'm going to enjoy this amazing food. Please digest it. Only take the nutrients that we need. Discard what we don't need. And if there's anything else you want from me to feed you nutritionally, please let me know. Ask your body to be a part of it. Set an intention for your food. And watch the experience you have with food change, for example. Why do we walk around feeling so heavy when we eat food? Because we're actually having an experience of eating food. We're not actually referring to the consciousness in the food. So we're having a consciousness, or we're having an unconscious experience of digestion. Once we involve the consciousness of the body, we engage the consciousness of the food, now an experience of emotional oneness has been activated. Does that make sense? It's amazing when you think of it that way. And when you constantly are engaging in a relationship with your body, like a child, what you teach yourself very clearly is, oh, they don't just give me attention when they want something. Oh, here they come. They're going to be sweet and nice to me. They must want something. Maybe they're trying to sweet talk me to give them that oneness experience. Oh, look how desperately they want that oneness with God experience. I'm going to hide it from them. I'm going to hide it from them until I'm enough, and only I'm enough. See, that's the shadow. You don't want to be on a spiritual path that feeds the shadow unintentionally. You want to make peace with your innocence that says, I'm so sorry that I spent so much of my life trying to be valued, validated, and honored by other people in my life who didn't treat themselves respectfully, who didn't know how to treat me with respect, and instead of being the one that loves you the way other people couldn't, I spent my life trying to earn the approval of people that were never designed to give me approval. And I'm sorry that I made people that didn't treat you properly more important than you. And like a child who says, hey, Mom, I know you're with your new lover, but I feel frightened in his presence. And Mom says, sorry, sweetie. This is who I'm with now. I've chosen them over you. See, that's what lurks in the recesses of our body, is a feeling that the world is more important than our innocence. Lovers are more important than your innocence. Jobs are more important than your innocence. Spiritual status and attainment is more important than your innocence. And why do you suppose you find relationships, they fall apart, you find jobs that feel good and they fall apart, and nothing fulfills you? Because this innocence says, you're not going to be fulfilled by any of it, because I'm your main priority. And I will deconstruct every joy in your life until there's nothing left for you to face but me. That's real. That's the real spiritual journey. And then when you start learning things like, oh, that's ego, I'm just going to sit and be silent and let it pass. It is an illusion. I'm not the body. Boy, does that piss off your innocence. All the spiritual one-liners just makes the shadow darker and angrier and turns consciousness into a cosmic Metallica concert. And consciousness can be a whole lot darker than we know how to pretend to be enlightened. So step number one is we make peace with our innocence, because bringing the mind and heart into holy matrimony, reuniting with the consciousness of our body, as if to say, I'm sorry you didn't feel loved and adored by other people in the past. I'm here to pay back the emotional debt of what people didn't give you, which is what karma is. I'm going to love you and love all of the feelings and thoughts that arises to pay back the debt that no one else was able to give you and clear the karma, because clearing the karma is I'm no longer at odds with my innocence. Bring my mind and my heart together as one. Let both dissolve into the light that collapses into the gut. And then from there, the experience of unity, oneness with God is experienced. But even that, as beautiful as an experience will be, will pale in comparison to the relief you feel when your innocence and you are on the same page and engaging in a heart-centered and trustworthy relationship. That's the gospel. And we all get there sooner or later because you hit what I call the spiritual wall. I love it. Boy, do I love the spiritual wall. Because it's when you start to realize, I've learned everything, I've kept it straight, I've been the greatest student, and it's all blowing up. and it's blowing up so we can really take a journey and get really honest with ourselves. Because the inner child just wants you to focus on two things in order for you to repair this relationship. And the two things are honesty and self-love. That's why I teach loving what arises, because I am not only here as a messenger of the universe, I'm here to help you make peace with your inner child so we can call tonight's transmission a message from your inner child. A message from your inner child. Your inner child doesn't care how spiritual you are, doesn't care what you try to remember and keep straight, and the more you try to wake up each day thinking, I'm going to do these things a certain way to earn my imaginary gold spiritual stars, boy, will it sabotage everything and make sure it doesn't happen. It doesn't care. All it cares about is that you learn to rely on it. If you can just stop and say, inner child, you are so important in my journey. I need you. I need you, and we're here to do this together. It will start to feel included in your journey, and all the things that you can't work hard enough to clear and cleanse out of your field will dissolve in the snap of the fingers. That's revolutionary. I'm not here to be a distraction from your innocence. I'm here to be the voice of your innocence. And I'm here to return you to your innocence. Because there's so many different spiritual levels of reality, enlightenment, as infinite stages of revelation. There's so much to this journey. But if we don't start totally whole within our innocence, you're going to hit the spiritual wall eventually. You only go so far if you don't start here. And if you start here, you'll spare yourself a lot of agony. Because if you start opening the door to oneness and you start having these experiences, but this is not totally in orientation, that's when things get real weird. Right? You're opening to the vast possibilities of the universe, but the shadow hasn't been dealt with. And so then you start experiencing just odd expressions of polarity. You start finding bigger spiritual monsters to run away from. Bigger spiritual barriers to overcome. That's where we find the superstitious of light and dark energy. The fearing of all these weird things entering our field and psychic attacks and all these things. It's because we're opening our crown to higher possibilities, but our heart is not rooted in oneness with our innocence. And we have the imbalance of an open crown and a closed heart. So we're spiritually interested and emotionally repressed at the same time. And I've said before, that makes us wise on a conceptual level with not so many social skills. We seem to know all the answers as long as we think life works that way, and it really doesn't. And sometimes you're in these weird situations where you'll bring your wisdom out to play, like, oh, someone's having a bad day, let me just bring my collection out for them. Have you ever had an experience where you start telling people things that are really deep, near, dear to your heart, and doesn't seem to do anything at work? You're like, why isn't this working? Because we have to root ourselves in our heart and get this relationship totally one. And then what happens is you'll be able to transform people's relationships just by sitting with them, not even talking anything spiritual. A true Buddha can just be the most peaceful person in someone else's reality and walk them up to the other side of the fence just by listening, not even saying anything spiritual. They can just agree with them. Yeah, sometimes life sucks. Yep, I agree. And in that moment, that Buddha is helping to repair the discordant relationship between mind and heart. Your mind's not the problem. Your ego's not the problem. Your subconscious beliefs aren't the problem. Your conditioning isn't the problem. Your family heredity isn't the problem. Your past life isn't the problem. These are just spiritual excuses you've been taught that pisses your inner child off. So let's make peace with the inner child right now. Let's have an experience where you can experience exactly what I'm talking about right now. Experience the immediate relief, because relief doesn't come from existential experiences. Existential experiences are extensions of emotional resolve. So we find emotional resolve, and the existential reality reveals itself on its own. But there's no better way to call forth the highest, most transcendent spiritual experience but when you are emotionally resolved and free of the very hunger of needing a transcendent experience. That's when we're mature enough to handle it. So let's just do and for some of us that are new, I do a lot of what I call repeat after me, where I'll say something and I have you kind of repeat it back to me. Because sometimes if you just hear me say things, it can be like, wow, that's really powerful. But it's almost like you're listening to what I say, and so it's about what I'm bringing forth. I want you to say what's coming through so your body can feel like you're coming up with it. Does that make sense? You get to actually have the experience. And again, just no expectations of what's going to happen. Just let's say it out loud and just see what happens. So try this out loud. Dearest inner child.
Dearest inner child.
I am so sorry.
I am so sorry.
If you've ever felt hurt, abandoned.
If you've ever felt hurt, abandoned.
Rejected or doubted.
Rejected or doubted.
By anyone in the past.
By anyone in the past.
Or if you've ever felt.
Or if you've ever felt.
That I have lived in a way.
That I have lived in a way.
That has excluded you from my experience.
That has excluded you from my experience.
Made you feel less than.
Made you feel less than.
Humiliated.
Humiliated.
If I judged you.
If I judged you.
By calling you an ego.
By calling you an ego.
By thinking that you're a barrier to God.
By thinking you're a barrier to God.
That you're something for me to get away from.
That you're something for me to get away from.
As if you weren't.
As if you weren't.
A pivotal part of my journey.
A pivotal part of my journey.
As if you weren't the guardian to my highest self.
As if you weren't the guardian to my highest self.
And I'm so sorry.
And I'm so sorry.
If my interest in spirituality.
If my interest in spirituality.
Made you feel.
Made you feel.
Like the invisible sibling.
Like the invisible sibling.
That's never enough for my attention.
That's never enough for my attention.
I'm sorry if lovers.
I'm sorry if lovers.
Seemed more important than loving you.
Seemed more important than loving you.
And when you felt unsafe around the people I surrounded myself with.
And when you felt unsafe around people I surrounded myself with.
I'm sorry I did not hear your requests.
I'm sorry I did not hear your requests.
And instead.
And instead.
Tried to desperately make people.
Tried to desperately make people.
That made you feel unsafe.
That made you feel unsafe.
Validate my existence. Instead of keeping you safe.
Instead of keeping you safe.
I'm so sorry.
I'm so sorry.
Please forgive me.
Please forgive me.
Let this moment.
Let this moment.
Be a restart.
Be a restart.
Where we make peace.
Where we make peace.
Allowing the mind and heart.
Allowing the mind and the heart.
To reunite.
To reunite.
And we come together.
And we come together.
In the oneness of love.
In the
To engage in consciousness.
To engage in consciousness.
So that the war within myself can end.
So that the war within myself can end.
And I can finally feel the joy of being myself.
And I can
as a conscious parent,
as a conscious parent, to my own innocence,
that no longer has to act so desperately,
that no longer has to act so desperately,
to earn my loving approval,
to earn my loving approval,
and no longer has to create,
and no longer has to create,
existential crisis. In order to motivate me to send love to it.
In order for me to send love to it.
I love you.
I love you.
I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Please forgive me.
Please forgive me.
I did not know how deeply you hurt.
I did not know how deeply you were hurt.
And I vow from this moment forward.
And I vow from this moment forward.
To be the one.
To be the one.
That keeps you safe.
That keeps you safe.
That allows you to speak whatever you need to say.
That allows you to speak whatever you need to say.
That listens to anything you want to share.
That listens to anything that you want to share.
And that loves and adores you.
And that loves and adores you.
As only I can love and adore you.
As only I can love and adore you.
That's spirituality. Any other focus other than repairing this relationship will turn something inherently beautiful about life into a spiritual object. And you'll either chase it as an object, you'll grasp it and covet it like an object you don't want to lose, that you'll hide from others so they don't get it all dented and dirty, that you'll lash out on the world when it seems to be missing. Everything can be objectified until you make peace with your innocence. Until we do, the innocence masquerades as shadow, which seems to be what you'll go around to all these spiritual groups to figure out how to unravel and resolve, and it makes it nastier. The shadow remembers everything you've learned in spirituality and still sits in the fury of you're trying to take me to all these other things, like as if a parent who takes their child to a psychologist and says, they won't follow my rules, fix them. That's what we inadvertently do. But when you come here, I am here not to play that game with you. I'm here to resolve the madness. Because otherwise, having that shadow in yourself, and especially, again, I don't blame anyone. We just don't know. We haven't been taught this. I mean, we were doing the best we can. We're interested in spirituality. We want to figure out how to be happy. Things don't make us happy. What am I going to do? I go on a spiritual path and I start learning things. And there's no fault in that. But I was brought here to start a revolution to free you of the shit that doesn't work. Because I'll tell you a funny little story. I realized a lot of this a long time ago, but all the teachings come through at this time because this is the time when we're all here to realize this on a big level. But when I realized, because I was having these deep spiritual realizations, I mean, I've had transcendent spiritual experiences since I was 6 years old. So my whole life has always been a spiritual odyssey, but I didn't get to the emotional resolve till like later in life. And once you have a taste of what this is really all about, it's fascinating. It's fascinating. I remember once I was sitting there and just kind of like reminiscing on like a oneness experience I'd had, where it's like I had merged with the light of all, just experienced that. Oh, that was so wonderful. And then the voice of the innocence you know, piped in and said something very poignant. You probably will laugh, but I thought it was very poignant. Because it's like when your innocence can say one thing, and consciousness is so gangster sometimes, that it can get to the point so fast that sometimes the best realizations create, how can I say this, a shift in attitude, right? Like sometimes we want a shift in perception, but what we actually need is a shift in attitude. And sometimes consciousness has to get a little gangster just to shift the attitude so quickly where you go, oh, I got it now, okay, woo, right? So I remember I was sitting there one day many years ago before I was teaching, oh, oneness, oh yes, that experience was nice. And I heard in my head a voice that said, yes, all is one, now go fuck yourself. What? Right. This is when I met the shadow. The anti-guru, right? What? What? I was like startled by that. What? I mean, and this is when people start to think, God, am I possessed? Is there something inside of me? Do I need an exorcism? I got a bar mitzvah. Do I need an exorcism? What is that? And that is consciousness rebelling about how pent up and boxed in it's felt by spirituality. As a way of saying, yeah, you know, you've realized a lot of cool, groovy spiritual things, but you haven't faced me yet. Now it's time that we play. And boy, was I not ready for that. And I faced it. And some of us don't have the experience of that inside of our hearts. Do you know what we have? We have that kind of interaction with other people. But it's the same energy. You ever have this experience of, oh, I'm in this really cool aligned place. How come everyone else is so in their ego? How come everyone else seems to getting nastier and weirder? Why am I all of a sudden more of a target and I'm more open? That's the shadow in your heart using other characters to try to get your attention, to say you're still not oriented. Once this is the focus, all of this changes on a dime. Everyone starts to get a lot nicer when you make peace with this. Isn't that weird? It's amazing. There's a weird level of consciousness where you start opening up to the one. I am one. We're all one. We're all spiritual masters. It's beautiful. Oh my God. But everyone in the world is starting to look meaner, is getting nastier. The world's getting more violent. People are like not seeing me. They're bumping into me. They're being ruthless towards me because it's the shadow within you manifesting itself in the behavior of others trying to get your attention and show you a bigger picture. All I needed was that one sentence to reorient my attention. And like I said, I've spent my entire life having guides, the universe, talk to me in every moment and guide me. I still wasn't immune from hearing that. It's not like I'm told the right answers and I do everything perfectly. It's not like that. You still make your own choices. You have to see everything on your own. And that for me was a cosmic attitude change. All of a sudden, without that voice saying so, all of a sudden, being kind to myself and practicing being kind to myself by how thoughtful I would be to others became my spiritual practice within the snap of a fingers. That one sentence shifted everything. I didn't get to this position by following instructions correctly. I came here because my attitude was shifted by my inner child. It said enough. And because I had no idea that's what needed to be addressed, I was like, hey, I didn't know. Just show me what to do.
Apparently
show me what you
that
need.
Child knows the F word.
Oh, it is. All inner children love the F word. All inner children love those words because it's the language of passion, of passion, right? And if we don't express passion and excitement, it gets repressed. And it becomes fury and anger. Like, have you heard the phrase, a crime of passion? It's because we don't express excitement and joy and let the intensity of our creative genius regularly flow. We become insane. People that act out maliciously and violently are emotionally repressed creative geniuses that don't have a canvas to express upon. And when that inner child comes to communicate with you, it says, you want to be free? You want to make peace with me? Let me out. Let me come out to play. And sometimes we say, well, are you going to follow all the conscious rules? No, I'm not. I am going to break every rule you've learned. I am going to be the opposite of everything you've learned. I am going to shake up your life like a snow globe. You're going to survive it, but watch what I'm going to do to you. Which is why the quote from Jesus was, if you bring forth what is within you, it will save you. And it's talking about the inner child. And if you do not bring forth what is within you, it will destroy you. That's what it's talking about. Isn't that interesting? We don't know what it's really like. We think we know what it's talking about, but when you hear this kind of a teaching, you go, oh, that's what we bring forth. And then we have this weird relationship that goes, but I don't want to bring you forth until I know you're going to act appropriately. And when you refuse to bring it forth, you're guaranteed to not act appropriately. But if you say, you know what? I'm going to bring you forth. Do whatever the hell you're going to do. You seem to want to step forward and come forth. And when you just say, I bring you forth as a way of saying, inner child, I trust you. Because if all is one, you could only be a manifestation of God. And if I inherently give trust to that which is within me, the only thing it's going to bring forth are the highest qualities. And if I refuse to bring forth what's within me, all I'm going to embody are the lowest qualities that causes me to run around these spiritual communities trying to have someone wiggle their magic fingers and make go away and disappear what will not disappear until you bring it forward. So if you bring it forth, highest qualities of God. If you keep it from coming forward, lowest qualities of shadow. That's the game. It wants to know that you trust it. If you trust it, let it lead you. Give the wheel to the inner child and let it steer the ship that already knows where it's going. Let your inner child sit in the passenger seat. Let you sit in the front seat and let it pretend it's steering the ship and turn every couple minutes and say, you're doing a good job, honey, we're almost there. Thank God you're driving. It's not the one that drives the ship. It just needs to be the one that knows you trust it to drive the ship. It's very cute. It's very innocent. So this is about respecting your inner child so that we don't need shadow to get our attention in such a drastic way. And I only bring forth the voice and the demeanor of it so you know that's what it is inside of me, so you don't misunderstand it as all these, you know, criteria and a spiritual checklist of, here, you know, do you experience this? Oh my God, yes I do. And then God bless some spiritual person that says, okay, I'm going to tell you how to get rid of it. Really? And meanwhile, there's a war brooding inside of you. Doesn't want to hear that crap at all. Wants to hear, I matter. Tell me I matter. Make me the object of your affection. Love me now. And it's not a matter of what do you have to lose. It's a matter of, why does it need to get any worse? Haven't you been through enough? I say you've had enough. I say you've had enough, so let's make peace with our heart and make taking care of ourselves, loving ourselves, and being honest our spiritual practice. It's the willingness to say, I have your back. If you have anything that you need to say, I'll be willing to be the voice that says out loud, and you don't have to say it to people. Most of the things that the inner child needs to say, it just needs to say out loud, not even around people that it might be about. It just needs to vocalize things. And what's interesting is if you're the one that says, look, anytime you have a discordant feeling, I say to that feeling, look, if there's something you need me to say for you, if you need me to be the the microphone for you and just give you the mic and just let you go off for a few minutes. I will totally let you say anything and everything, no matter how spiritually incorrect or politically incorrect it is, in the privacy of my home, I'll just bring it forward. And 9 times out of 10, nothing will actually arise because the inner child is looking at you as, I just want to know I have the right to say anything. And when you do, you gain trust within yourself. And when there's complete trust and unity within the innocence, the inner child goes from being this little kid to being the guardian of your soul who starts opening doors within you, which changes the things you attract to you. That's the law of attraction. So we just have to do things in a different order. Whether it's enlightenment, awakening, healing, law of attraction, ascension, it all is stemming from make peace with your innocence first. Innocence is your heart. Your heart is the kingdom of heaven, which is why the quote is, enter the kingdom first and all these things and more will be given to you. Make peace with this. You've had enough. And I had had a lifetime of spiritual experiences. And do you know what the beauty of my lifetime of spiritual experiences was? I've had so many spiritual experiences that when I had that voice arise that said what I said earlier, it made me realize I've had so many spiritual experiences. Those spiritual experiences taught me that the spiritual experiences were neither the solution to my problems, nor was the absence of the spiritual experiences the cause of my problems. It was all my alignment with my innocence. Because my whole life was stemmed on, who do I have to be as a performer in reality to get other people to like me? And the message I was sending to my inner child was, you're not enough as you are. Once these people like me, then I'll like you. And eventually it caught up with me. And there's nothing wrong with that because it catches up with all of us. We just don't know. We're not here to be blaming each other. We're just like, I didn't know. Of course you didn't know. And that innocence in you is so forgiving and so loving that once you honorably say, Jesus, I didn't know. I'm so sorry. Boom. Life changes on a dime. And from that step forward, every moment of success, abundance, transcendence, healing, transformation can be called forth in your reality at will once your relationship with your innocence has been resolved. It's so important. And you can feel the gravity of what I'm saying. And on some level, you will never forget how important what I'm saying is. It's that deep. It's so deep that every other spiritual milestone, which is beautiful, there's nothing wrong with it, but at a certain point, it all becomes like the so what factor. Enlightenment, so what? Really? There are many stages way beyond enlightenment. So what? Oneness, so what? Peace and autonomy with your innocence and the willingness to bring forth your creative genius. That's everything. That's everything. So in the new paradigm enlightenment is not just one who knows themselves as the one, not just one who's fully embodying the one, who is fully returned back into full embodied oneness, but one who has completely resolved the relationship with their innocence so they can be the one who resolves the relationship of innocence for others just by being in their presence. As if the silent gaze of that enlightened one plants I love yous in your heart. The personality is not of the ego. It's of your soul's signature. The soul has a personality. It is unique. The soul has dreams. The soul has desires, and it has journeys. None of that's ego. Oddly enough, not even ego is ego, because ego is just a costume the innocent wears to get your attention. Ego is more of a state of inflammation. Ego is like a state of energetic inflammation that causes your reality to be obscured and causes you to act desperately when your nervous system is overstimulated. So ego is almost a function, not an object or an idea. And if you just begin to engage with the innocence of your heart, you'll start to resolve that inflammation, start to make peace with your innocence, and start to turn all this around so quickly. And then you will begin to feel the joy of being yourself. And you will take the real spiritual journey of transforming inferiority into the autonomy of the infinite one that you are. From inferior to infinite, one I love you at a time.